And so we're in the Old Testament. We're following the story of God as he's led the people all the way from the story of Adam and Eve. And we've gone through the Exodus. We've been released from freedom, into freedom, I mean. We've been given the promised land. We've had kings who have led us. Some of the kings have been good and some of the kings have been bad. And then we've got lost again. It's as if we're in the wilderness years all over again. And God has exiled some of us to away to a foreign land. And the temple and the whole city of Jerusalem has come into disrepute and fallen down. The buildings are falling down. They've been uncared for. Thank you so much. That's great. I'm not sure what that is. Is that? It was on the floor. There was a mobile phone on the floor, if you know anybody who knows that. I thought it was an audio thing, but it's not. No, great. So we got to Nehemiah. I'm going to read chapter 1 of Nehemiah. The words of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah. In the month of Kislev, in the 20th year, when I was in the citadel of Susa, Hanani, one of my brothers, came from Judah with some other men, and I questioned them about the Jewish remnant that survived the exile, and also about Jerusalem. Basically, Nehemiah is asking his friends, what's the news from Jerusalem? And they said to me, those who survived the exile are back in the province. They're in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down, and its gates have been burned with fire. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. And then I said, O Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and obey his commands. Let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's house, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We've not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if your exiled people are at the farthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people, whom you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. O Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. I was the cupbearer to the king. This is the word of the Lord. I'd like to welcome Joel up. Father God, as Joel comes, we pray for him, pray for our own ears. May we be attentive to what you have to say through him, through this word, through scripture. May our eyes be open as we listen and watch for you, for what you might have to say to us. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning. Welcome to you if you snuck in after the first welcome or even the second welcome. It's great to have you here. If you're new or you're visiting us, particularly warm welcome. As Rich said, my name's Joel and I'm the curate here on the staff team. And I'm not running the half marathon today, and I see neither are you. I don't see the point. I'm not quite sure the purpose. We are looking at Nehemiah this morning, and particularly focusing on three things: compassion, confession, and justice. I don't know what you enjoy in life, what your sort of hobbies are, the things that you like to do. One of my kind of hobbies and activities is I really like design. I like all aspects of design. I like graphic design, and particularly at the moment, I'm in a phase where I'm thinking about form and structure and function. Particularly thinking about furniture and things that are originally one thing but have been created into something else. Here's some pictures. They're pretty self-explanatory. I quite like the middle one. There's an idea, isn't there? Turning your pews into kind of bed heads with side tables. I kind of like that. The piano, I think that's sacrilege, personally. I'm a musician, love music. Phone box, that would be quite fun, wouldn't it? But it begs the question, should these things, are these things what they should be? Or have they moved away from what they should be? Their purpose, what is the point? Are they now fulfilling their true purpose? Or have they moved away from what their true purpose is? I wonder today if you can think in your own life. Have you, perhaps, do you feel like you've moved away from something that you should be? Or do you feel like you need to move towards something you could be? Maybe you're not being who you're meant to be. You have that feeling, perhaps that sense, I'm not really me. Perhaps you don't feel like you're doing the thing that you should be doing in life, that true sense of vocation, that true sense of fulfillment, your intended purpose. Maybe you feel this with your work. Maybe you feel this in your relationships. Maybe you recognize you're not quite the grandma or granddad or whatever you like to call that. In our household, grandma's called Doddy. Random, but she is. That's her name. We love Doddy. Maybe mum, dad, daughter, son, sister, brother, husband, wife, or friend. Just there's that recognition that I'm not quite what I should be. I know I could be something else. I'd like to be kind of almost like a better version of the thing that I am now, but I'm struggling to get there. This is a story. Nehemiah's story is one of moving from something that was very ordinary in life to something very extraordinary. He started, his job was a cupbearer to the king. Does that sound normal to you, being a cupbearer to the king? Does that sound like ordinary life? Well, that was his job. You know, that was ordinary for him. To suddenly becoming this project manager of this big building project, this construction project. And after that, he became the governor of the land. He just went from something very simple for him, very ordinary in life, to something that was completely extraordinary. But it was actually his true purpose, his higher purpose, his holy purpose. I've done many things in life. I know I look like I'm only about 14. I'm not. I've had a few years' experience. I wonder if you've done any of these things. Paperboy? Anyone been a paperboy or a paper girl? Don't want to stereotype. Data entry? Yeah, done that. Banks, all that stuff. A tree surgeon? Any tree surgeons? There we go, there's one. I've done a bit of that. That was my first job, completely illegal, but it was so fun. I worked in music publishing for a number of years. I really enjoyed that and thought that that was going to be my life's work, but God had other plans. Okay, this picture is of a novelty gift shop. Anyone worked in a novelty gift shop selling tat? I did that for a summer, every Saturday for a summer. And I even worked for the CPS, again, kind of data entry, compiling there. Putting nice red ribbons around folders, basically. and now I'm here. That's my progression. That's my career path. It's a good one, isn't it? I wonder about you, what you've done, where you're going to, whether you feel like you're in the right thing now, or perhaps there's something else you're meant to be doing, something else, a more holy kind of ordained purpose for your life. Nehemiah's story was this. He woke up, he went to work, he came home again, he relaxed, and he went to bed, and he did that on repeat every single day. Anyone do that? Yeah, that's kind of my life. This is the rhythm of life, the rhythm of the day. Nehemiah woke up in a place called Susa. It was kind of a region, an area. He went to work in the palace. That was his ordinary, that was his job. And to relax, he spoke to his family and his friends, amongst other things. This story, let's go through it. This story, we see in verse 2 that he met up with Hanani. Sounds like a girl's name, doesn't it? One of my brothers. And he met up with some other men. That's how he came to relax. And a conversation began. And it was a conversation that centered on Jerusalem and the people living in Jerusalem, the people that had survived the exile, the remnant in the land. Nehemiah asked this question. He questioned them, verse 2 again. You might like to have your Bible in front of you so you can follow this through today. He questioned them about the Jewish remnant that survived the exile and also about Jerusalem. Tell me what's going on. I need to know. I want to know. Tell me about the people. He would have had friends. They would have had family there. I want to know how people are. What are they doing? How are their spirits? Are they high spirits or low spirits? You know, there's been some transition in that place, some shaky stuff happening. I want to know. And he wants to know about the physical Jerusalem, the place, Jerusalem. And also Jerusalem, the city itself. Tell me about the city. Verse 3, a report comes back, and his brother and his friend said to him this: those who survived the exile are back in the province, that's good, and are in great trouble and disgrace, that's not good. They're back where they should be, but emotionally, they're going through some stuff that's really hard for them right now. Persecution, hard times. The city itself, well, Jerusalem is not what it was. Jerusalem, remember, this huge city with fine walls and big gates. Amazing, glorious city. And now the walls have fallen down and the gates are being burnt up. This would have broken Nehemiah's heart. Nehemiah would have been so invested in Jerusalem. It would have been so just tugged at his heartstrings. And his reaction, I don't know how you react to negative news, bad reports, pain and suffering, acute need. When you see things on screens, when you hear things on the news, I wonder what your response is, whether it kind of just gets you inside. Nehemiah, verse 4, says this: when I heard these things, I sat down and I wept. And for some days I mourned and fasted, and I prayed before the God of heaven. He was deeply affected by this news. I mean, really, it hit him hard. When you see images, I remember as a kid, some of these things being newer than others, comic relief, children in need. Do you remember just seeing the images of children, excuse me, across the world, and people across the world from starvation, from famine, from drought? Significant need, Band-Aid, children in need in our own country, the response to human need. And I remember just as a kid being just kind of cut to the core, just completely overwhelmed by what I saw on TV. And I remember walking past, I used to live fairly near London, And we used to go there quite often. And I remember walking past a number of homeless people and just, as a kid, just remember that gut, like, this is not right. This does not feel good inside. But I think what happens is that we become acclimatized to these things. The more we see, the less we feel. I feel like sometimes it has the opposite effect. So we hear news sometimes about war-torn countries. It's just another... It's a war-torn country. We see this all the time. It's bad, but do you know what I mean? That it doesn't affect me quite as much as it used to. I've become used to the thing, acclimatized. But Nehemiah here is deeply troubled. When was the last time you were deeply troubled by bad news? Right in your gut. He mourned, he fasted and prayed. In Jewish culture, people used to think 6 inches down, and they used to feel 6 inches down. Do you ever get that? Oh, just that, this is not, you feel it, butterflies. When you're nervous, where do you feel your nerves? No, it's in your gut. This is what we're hearing, that gutty just... This is not right, God. This is just not right. It makes him feel so ill. He's so troubled by this news. And that is deep, deep compassion. And when we read the words of Jesus in the Gospels, the stories of Jesus when he had compassion, it wouldn't have been this nice feeling, oh, isn't I feel sorry for them? I feel pitiful for them. It wouldn't have just tugged on his heartstrings. It wouldn't have just been, oh man, I feel that's bad. It would have been, oh my goodness, this is just not right. This is just not what it should be. These people, the things that they're going through is so far away of what they should be going through. How many people has this happened to? Your car's broken down on the side of a road. Have you had that experience? I have that experience too often. And how many people drive past you? I mean, a lot of people just, they don't have the time, do they? Sorry, mate, things to do, places to go. I mean, that's if they even look at you. That's even if they notice you. I remember one time I was driving in this beat-up old Nova. It was going to break down, wasn't it? It was my granddad's car. And I broke down on a roundabout. The worst place you can break down. And I didn't know what to do. I put my hazards on. This was kind of before mobiles were like commonplace. And people just rushing by, just rushing past. And until this one person stopped. And I was so grateful. And they helped me push the car out the way. They had more than pity on me. I'm sure they did pity me, but they probably felt, I've got to do something. This is not right. This is unsafe. I've got to move this car on. We've been thinking about higher purpose over the last few weeks. And particularly for us Christians, that our holy purpose, our higher purpose is to be holy people. To live lives for God, living for God. And we kind of wrap this up with this language of priests. I don't know what your image of a priest is in your head. If I said priest, I wonder what you would think. I have a number of images. I was thinking about wearing my dog collar today, but you can visualize that without that. But you are all priests. You belong to the priesthood of all believers. The last few weeks we began in the book of Genesis, and we thought what it meant to be a priest was to be an image bearer of God, to be a steward of his creation. We moved on to tabernacle and temple worship, to be worshippers of God. That's what it means to be a priest, to be a worshipper of God, but more than worshipper, to be worship leaders, to lead others in worship of God. Last week, you may remember, we looked at Daniel together, about set apart, being holy, making different choices, good choices, holy choices for God. today, there's some things that we can learn from Nehemiah, some priestly markers, and they are this, that he was a man of compassion. We've already looked at that. Secondly, that he was a man of prayer. Thirdly, that he was a man of confession. And fourthly, that he was a man of justice. So priestly markers, we've had image bearers, stewards, worship leaders, being holy. Today, add four to the list: compassion, prayer, confession, and justice. This is who we are called to be. This is what it means to operate as priests today. A compassion like Jesus. Do you remember, so often in the Gospels, it says, and he had compassion on them. Jesus had compassion on them. This was his first response. A first response, not simply seeing human need, but feeling human need. And he healed them. And he fed them. And he released them. And he set them free. First and foremost, he had compassion. Like Nehemiah, like Jesus, we're called to feel. Feel for the other person. Feel for what is not right in the world. It's supposed to get us. We looked at the Holy Spirit at Alpha on Wednesday evening. And we spoke about the sense that the Spirit of God brings to life the Spirit that's within us. Deep calling to deep. Spirit calling to Spirit. We have wonderful things built into us as humans. Good things. Courage. Boldness. Strength. Integrity. And the Spirit of God brings these to life. He breathes fire into these things and makes them real in our lives and helps us to live these things out. We each have within us huge amounts of compassion, just lying latent, just lying dormant, waiting to come alive in us. And the Spirit of God brings that to life in us. Brings the closer we get to God by his Spirit, the more alive we become in these things and in compassion. Secondly, he was a man of prayer. Verse 4, read with me. You don't have to read out loud. When I heard these things, I sat down and wept. For some days I mourned and fasted and prayed. I prayed before God. First response, prayer. First response, prayer. Heard about a situation, saw a situation, and prayed. How often is that our first response? I'm a man of action. I like to get on with things. I'm a man of, I have a tendency towards immediacy. I like to get going, just get going with the job. Here's the problem. Okay, I get it. Let's find the solution. Let's sort it out. Let's get it done. Nehemiah was like, whoosh, step back a second. Step back a second. God, this is what's going on. This is the situation. It was like he was, prayer was like an upload to God. You know, we have this language of upload and download, become very trendy in the last 2 decades. And prayer was uploading stuff to God. Lord, this is how I'm feeling. This is the situation. This is what's going on. This is what's happening. That was his first response. And as priests, as holy people, to fulfill our purpose as those set apart for God, our first response must be God-focused, must be prayerful, prayer-focused. Verse 6 and 7 says this, let your ear be attentive, this is his prayer to God, and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you night for your night day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's house, have committed against you. So he's confessing on behalf of others as well as himself. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed your commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses. Confession, I recognize that I have not done something that I should have done. As simple as that. His prayer was beyond, his confession was beyond himself. I don't know if you confess on behalf of other people. Is that something you've done before? Is that something that you do often? It may be that something is highlighted in our life that is, bless you, that is concerning the sins that have been committed years past by our ancestors. Generationally, things can just be passed up the line. And we can bear the effects of that. There's like a legacy that has been placed years and years and years and years ago that we are still being affected by. We are called to confess sometimes on behalf of those who have passed away years and years and years ago. And sometimes this can be incredibly releasing. It can be what sets us free to be the people that we are meant to be. The church, sometimes these places, believe it or not, although they're set apart for God, pick up some bad stuff. It may be that the money's not been used properly. It may be that the worship has been consumeristic. It may be that the worship has been focused on anything but God. It may be that the baggage of robes and choirs or guitars and drums are not quite what God would have. They're not honouring to God. Sometimes confession on behalf of others in a church setting means saying, God, we don't know, but potentially things have not been right in this place. Maybe things have gone amiss. We want to say sorry. And that can be incredibly releasing. Incredibly releasing, and move people forward into who they're really supposed to be. Whole churches, buildings released into their higher purpose, really what they're meant to be. Locally, I wonder what it would look like to confess on behalf of Twerton. I think there's some bad stuff happened in Twerton over the years that potentially as residents, this is the identity that we are taking on. Maybe we need to confess to God. And we can do this nationally, and we can do this internationally as well. Things, we have gone away from your purpose, God, your higher purpose. Verse 11, Nehemiah was a man of justice, and as priests, to fulfill our purpose in God, to walk in that holy purpose, we are called to be people of justice. Verse 11 says this, O Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this, your servant, and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Here we go. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. Well, this is being written in a bit of a strange way, because we don't quite know. If we were just to proofread this, just read this as an isolated text, we wouldn't quite know what Nehemiah was going on about until we read chapter 2. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. Nehemiah, in the process of prayer, received from God a download. He'd upload in prayer, and God downloaded to him a load of, this is the plan, this is the action, this is the response, this is what you were called to do. And what does it look like? Well, in chapter 2, we hear more of the story. The man was the king. Nehemiah was going to go before the king. And the king would grant him favor and success and permission, etc., etc., etc. Have you ever had it where, in prayer, you've just received the answer? You've received the strategy. You've received the action. You know exactly what you're supposed to do. After you've opened your eyes, after you've left that prayer meeting, okay, God, thank you. I've got great clarity over this situation. I know the way forward. Thank you. And Nehemiah actioned it. He got on with it. Chapter 2, the plan. Let me read on, and if you've got it in front of you, that would be helpful. So Nehemiah walks into the king, verse 1, doing his job, getting on with the day-to-day stuff. And maybe he was planning on talking to the king about it, maybe not. But the king makes the first move. The king says, why are you so sad? Are you ill? This can't be anything but sadness of the heart. Something is affecting you deep inside. I can see it. And the plan then escalates from there. Nehemiah is given permission, given wood, given men to carry on with a task that he's been given of rebuilding Jerusalem. But was it right? How do we know whether the thing that God has said to us is right? Here's one test. It's affirmed by others. Nehemiah did not walk into the king and tell him, this is what I need to do. The king initiated the conversation. I think that was a signal to him, God, this is your plan. This is your purpose. I'm going to get on with this. When I was 22, something like that, I just finished university and I thought that I was going to go into a career in music publishing. I thought that was what I was supposed to do. And I was at a church in Oxford, and someone invited me to come on the staff team for a year and be an intern, like an apprentice, particularly with worship stuff. This was the church on the left-hand side, not the shop, the church. And I didn't know whether it was right. I had no idea whether it was right, but I had conversation after conversation, releasing of money to me, lots of things identified to me that what I had heard from God, that I should go and work for this church, not for the internship, was right. And it was like, you know, when you walk down the high street and you just feel the doors of shops open. You don't even want to go in them. You're just walking a bit too close to them and they open and the warm air kind of hits you. And it was like that. It was like, oh, okay, this is right. There's no pushing involved. There's no pulling involved. It was just, this is clear. This is obvious. This is what I should be doing. In Nehemiah, we saw the plan was affirmed by others. Chapter 2, we see resources are released. He went to the king and he asked for wood, and the wood... the king said, go and chop down wood. Resources were released. A team was formed. He was released with people to help him. And here's an interesting thing I learnt this week. The rebuilding of the walls and the repairing of the gates was done in 52 days. 52 days. That's nothing. Think how long it takes them to put up, you know, student accommodation or new shops. It's not 52 days, is it? Amazing. But it was in line with God's purpose. I think this is the thing. It was in line with God's purpose, and it just was right. And then he was invited into senior leadership. At the end of the project, he was invited to be governor of the land. The Gospels say, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Sometimes we think, how can I get this thing? How can I make this happen? I'll seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's not right. It's not right. Seek first, the first thing that you seek, is the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And everything else will then be added to you. And we saw that Jesus did this all the time. All the time. He felt in his gut, he prayed to his Father, he retreated and prayed to his Father, he acted, he was obedient, he did what his Father told him to do. And guess what? Things changed around him, situations changed, people came back to life, people were healed, people were fed, people were released from demonic possession. Ultimate act. We might say the ultimate purpose was seen on the cross. Where compassion and justice were united, they were intermingled, they were brought together, and death was beaten. For God so loved the world, compassion. Compassion founded on God's love. God so loved the world. He felt hurt. He felt angry that the world was not what it should be. He felt it in the core of his being. I want this relationship back. I want my people back. I want to restore. I want to renew. that he gave his only son. He gave his only son justice. He loved, he gave compassion, justice. He felt, he did. And death was beaten. And we sung it this morning. The grave was beaten. It was overcome. It's the high purpose of the cross. How about Twerton Nehemiah's? It's got a ring to it, Twerton Nehemiah's. Imagine if we got the Nehemiah vision for Twerton. The God vision. Not our nice ideas, not our nice concepts of what might be good, what strategy, what plan might be right, but God's plan. Seek first the kingdom of God, God's kingdom, his plan, and his righteousness. Imagine that. Nehemiah wanted the place, Jerusalem, populated with the people of God. And he went out of his way to kind of purge the area of anything that wasn't godly and to fill it with the people of God. Well, imagine if this place came alive, people just became the people of God. And this place, walls started being repaired, gates repaired, people becoming who they were meant to be. Moving away from wickedness towards righteousness. That's the purpose. What's the purpose of Twerton? It's got to be more than this, hasn't it? Cleansed and restored. Twerton's higher purpose. So we're talking here not about our purpose individually, not just you and me and the part that we play in God's purpose, but a purpose for a whole area, a purpose for this. What's the purpose of this church? Well, what part are we playing in God's kingdom and God's righteousness? And what about Twerton? Well, I'd like to invite us to pray together. And would you like to stand with me? Lord, we want to thank you for your love for us. We want to thank you that you have not given up on us. We want to thank you that you see our brokenness. You see our hurt. You see our pain. And you feel deeply for us. You love us deeply. And you have not let us be. You've not left us alone, abandon us. But you come and you rebuild, you restore, you act with justice. You do the right thing. Come, Holy Spirit, we pray. And as we remember again the promise of your compassion and justice on the cross through these physical representations, would you speak to us deeply? Stir in us the word that you would have us hear this morning. For Christ's name, amen.